howdy, 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 folks. I am glad to be here, and I've missed you. So where you been? I've been busy, and I'm going to tell you about something real quick. We're going to talk about the top five things your inspector is going to check and talk about what you can do to prevent any problems. You may get a surprise inspection and whatever, and I get calls from vendors that go, oh, man, I'm scared to death the inspector's going to show up. And then I go, why would you be scared that the inspector's going to show up? And then they'll tell me why. Welcome to the show, the hot dog show. But we're going to talk a little bit first about lemonade. I have seen so many vendors. Thanks for the thumbs up. I've seen so many vendors this year, and I've helped so many vendors this year either add lemonade vending to their business or to start with lemonade and work up. Not that you quit lemonade vending. It's just a path to getting what you want quick. My sisters wanted I'm going to give you the short version. They wanted to make extra money. This is just 2 weeks ago. And I said, here's what you need to do. And they did it. And within 24 hours, they had made over $500 in free cash money. I say free, they worked for it, but in immediate cash. It was in a cash infusion. We had another vendor, brand new, did over $3,000 in 2.5 days right on his first time out. Okay, so there's a lot of value in lemonade vending. And so what I did is I wrote a course on exactly what I told my two sisters. I have two sisters that are younger than me, and they're in their, 30s and 40s. And I help them get going. Hey, David. Hey, Bubba. Eric, glad y'all are here. Tommy's here. Jeanette's here. Raymond's here. Thanks for being here. So what I want to tell you, and some of you have already, if you're on my email list, you already know this, or you've already read the story, because I published it on the blog. But I'll tell you where it is real quick. If you go, it's in the comment, or not the comments, but the description, video description, I put it there as well. But how to start a lemonade vending business. I can check that for you real quick. I think it is. Let me see how to start a lemonade business. howtostartalemonadebusiness.com. And I can put that here in the chat as well, if that'll help. So let me pull my screen back up so I know what I'm doing. All right, so anyway, it looks cross-eyed when I start reading, doesn't it? That's because that inbreeding in Tennessee, we tend to be a little cross. I'm just kidding. So anyway, why I wanted to come on here was to help you. Thanks for the thumbs up. I appreciate it. I wanted to share with you, because a big fear for vendors is that initial inspection, which I've talked about, and we even have a video of a vendor being inspected his first time before he's operating. It's his inspection to get his license to operate. But then there's that next inspection, that one that just shows up. You don't know when. You kind of know when, because if you're a vendor like me and you move around, and you got your spots that you're going to be on Thursdays, the second Thursdays of each month, and you know which or where you're going to be on the second Tuesday of each month, then it's the inspector calls you and goes, where are you going to be next Tuesday? I need to come by and check on you. And then you kind of got a heads up. But sometimes you're in a good, faithful location, and here comes the, the food Nazis, food safety Nazis. And I know you're probably, a lot of people call me and they're scared, literally scared of what's going to happen. And I'm gonna ease those fears. First, I want to tell you that these people aren't Nazis. They some of them take their job a little too serious. Okay, not that food safety is not serious, but they let their job title go to their head. They let the power go to their head. But let me tell you how it works. When they show up, okay, surprise, surprise, you're nervous, okay? I've had it happen. I was nervous. But what you have to remember is this is a human being, somebody that goes to Walmart, somebody that has car problems, somebody that sometimes can't pay the electric bill on time. These are these people. They put on their pants legs one leg at a time, just like you and I, unless you're super magic cool, and you can do it just jumping into them. I can't do that. So No problem here at church. That's funny. Carl says, I'm at church. I'll catch you later and view it later. No problem, brother. Pray for me. So anyway, thanks for checking us out. So anyway, let me tell you what to expect, okay? So now you know they're human. And if you can remember that, they're human. They're just human, okay? They have some authority, but they're human. They eat like us. They do things that we do. They're just normal people. What you do is know the five things they're going to look for. And if you keep those five things good, you're probably going to pass with flying colors every freaking time. I've never heard of a vendor not. But I'm going to also tell you the five things that are the major violations. And coincidentally, they're the same, pretty much just a different order. Okay? So I'm going to tell you the five things that they look for real quick. Okay, so when the inspector shows up, here's what that inspector, he or she, is going to look for immediately. Five things. First one, improper holding temperatures. They'll ask you, do you have your thermometer? Now, most people, you know, we keep one in the cooler already. We have one either in our apron or in our pocket, and it's our food thermometers. It doesn't matter if it's digital or not. I've not heard of any states requiring digital yet, but it is nice to have the instant read digital because it's real quick. And they'll ask you if you have one, not to use it. They'll just see if you have it, because if you don't have it, it means how are you checking your food temps, right? Now, here's the other thing. They're going to check temperatures, more than likely, immediately. They're going to look in your cooler and check that thermometer, right? They're going to check it. Then, or they're going to use theirs. If it's an instant read, cold read, they'll know, okay? Then they're going to come over to your food, and they'll dip it into your food. Now, they'll ask you how long it's been there. Now, I don't know if you know this. I've read all 50, this is no joke, all 50 states' codes. Okay, and everyone that I can remember, okay, requires a time to heat up. They call it a time to rethermalize. So you take a cold product and you're bringing it up to heat. And this is why they'll ask this question, because there is a leeway there. Some of them have a 2 to 3 hour leeway. They'll go, oh, we give you 3 hours to bring it up to temperature, or we give you 45 minutes to bring it up to temperature. Well, how long has this been here? Oh, I just put those dogs in 15 minutes ago. You just exonerated yourself from food temps on that, because they're giving you time to bring it up to temp, right? So if they check it and it's a little cold. Now, you don't want it to be cold, because food safety, it needs to be above 143 on hot stuff. It needs to be above 143. Some states are 141. It's 6 of 1, half a dozen the other. That's the point where germs are killed, okay? Food-borne illness-type germs. So they're going to check for proper temperatures. If they get a bad reading, you can say, hey, I just put that in there. They're probably still frozen in the middle. I just put them in the boiling water. Then you're okay, okay? Because they have to give you a time, all 50 states have a time to bring it to the thermalization temp. Okay? So don't worry about that one, but always have that thermometer with you. Always. Okay? I keep two. If I'm working a cart, I have two. Plus the one that stays in the cooler. Stays there. Then I have the other two. That way, when he dips my chili, I already know what it's going to be. Okay? And I say he. It could be a she, but when they dip the chili, you'll know what it's going to be. Now, the other thing is poor hygiene. Speaking of which, smoking. Shouldn't be smoking in or around your cart at all, zero, zip, none. Okay? And I'm an avid smoker. I'm like an athletic smoker. So what you have to do is poor hygiene. Let me give you an example. Okay? You see my nails? You see that little bit of dirt under my nails? That right there is a no-no. Okay, that's poor hygiene. Okay, you also washing your hands regularly is poor hygiene. They may stand off before you even know they're there. Stand back and watch you. They'll watch you. And if you are taking money, even with a gloved hand, okay, and then go grab a bun with that same gloved hand, you just failed that portion of the test, okay? And they're going to mark it down, and then they're going to let you know that you got an 85 instead of 100 because that not keeping hygiene up. So wash your hands. This is common sense stuff, but it's easy to get in a rush and not think. So if you start with good habits of every time you touch something with that gloved hand that wasn't supposed to be. Let's say you're kind of in the sun and you reach up and grab that umbrella and tilt it. You need to immediately change gloves. As long as you change gloves, you're good. You don't have to wash your hands, but you got to change gloves. But it's always better to wash your hands. Wash your hands. That's why there's a hand sink. Okay? So the other one is inadequate cooking. Okay? This is the third one. I hope you're following along. Third one is inadequate cooking. So you, in a rush, partially re-thermalize, which is called heat up. Okay? Heat up that food. You partially heat up that food. Thanks for the thumbs up. I keep seeing those come up, and I appreciate it. It motivates me. I'm telling you, it's an ego thing, and that's why they do that, because it works on our little psyche brains. Okay? So, anyway, they have that, they're watching for inadequate cooking. Did you, let's say you moved a batch of hot dogs and sausages over to the steam table, but the steam table wasn't hot yet, but you're going to be serving out of there? Well, those are going to drop in temperature quick. Let's say somebody wants Coke onions, my Coke onion recipe, on their dog. You just realized you don't have any hot. And so you quickly take some out, pour it in a pan, stir it up real quick, but you don't get it to full temp. Okay? That's inadequate cooking. Okay? Doesn't happen that much, but it's still one of the top five. Okay? And I'm going to explain these here in just a second the other way. The things that vendors are, even food truck vendors and hot dog cart vendors and lemonade vendors, this is where they fail if they fail, okay? 99% of the time. These are the top five. Contaminated equipment. Give you an example. You, as a vendor, let's say you have handles on your cart, and you take your tongs and hang them over the handle. Some inspectors consider that contamination immediately, and it kind of is. FDA Chapter 4 says it is. So it's a common place to put them, okay? It is. But if you put them there, that's considered food contamination because they don't know whose hands have been on those. It doesn't take but seconds for germs to move. Y'all have heard of the 3-second rule, right? You drop some food on the floor. Oh, 3-second rule, I'm good to go. No, you ain't. Takes less than a second for germs to get on there. In fact, it's instant. They've proved it. So you can literally get germs on something you drop instantly. Doesn't have to go into a bowl of pig slop. It can go on a dry surface. So if you're hanging those on your handles or hanging them off your umbrella, I saw a guy the other day hung it off his umbrella rack. That's a no. Okay? It's potential contamination, cross contamination they call it. Also, here's another cross contamination. You're busy with your tongs, busy. You take your tongs and you dip them into the hot water. You get a dog out and you throw it on there. You get your ladle for your chili, and then you go, oh, you wanted a slaw dog, and you drop your tongs for your slaw. Okay, and you go, or your spoon for your, and you go, oh, I'll just use the chili one. Cross-contamination. No joke, that's cross-contamination, not a good one. You don't want to cross-contaminate foods or cross-contaminate, even though you're putting that same thing right there on the dog, okay? It's still a considered cross-contamination because now they want you to clean that. And that's why I say to always have redundant equipment. always, I ain't talking about two hot dog carts on standby. I'm talking about an extra ladle, an extra set of tongs, maybe two sets. I've dropped them before. I've gotten busy, pulled my gloves off, dropped the tongs. Oh, crap. I ain't going to go wash those tongs real quick. Can you imagine that? You're standing at my cart waiting to eat, and you see me go over there and wash my tongs, no matter how good I wash them, and start using them again. Still in your head is, he just dropped them damn tongs on the floor or the ground. See what I'm saying? Doesn't look good. So you don't want to always have a backup set. That's what you want. So you can also have contamination where you are setting up. You're setting up to serve, and this is a common one with vendors. They take the bun out with their tongs or even with their gloved hand, and then they set it on top of their cart, or they set it where it's partway on the cart and partway on the aluminum foil wrapper or partway in the boat, the hot dog boat. That's a no-no. That's cross-contamination. If they see that, it's not like they're going to run up there with guns blazing and going, hey, you're done. You're out of here. See ya. Strike three. No. What they'll do is write it up, and they'll go, hey, you did these things. That's why your score is a 60. Okay? You don't want a 60 score. Now, here's another one. Food from an unsafe source. Okay? And I've seen some vendors do this, and you can look on YouTube, and you'll see some too. I filmed a vendor in Knoxville, Tennessee, and filmed him for a couple hours. 360 cameras, the works. I never showed that video, because if you wanted to know how not to do a cart, that was how not to do a cart. Because there wasn't anything done correctly. It was a mess. It was a nasty, filthy mess. That stuff is that gets, that's what gets vendors shut down. Plus, if they didn't even shut you down, how would you like to know you killed three people? And you may be going, oh, how am I going to kill somebody? Well, Papaw shows up with Mamaw, going to stop and get her a hot dog. You know, and they get a hot dog, and you've cross-contaminated the sour cream or the coleslaw or the cream cheese or anything. And now they got some virus that they can't fight off as quick, and they die. People die from foodborne illness every day. So keep that in mind. You need to think that through. Jeff Mack just asked, and let me pull this back up so I can, it's a good question. Jeff says, where do you keep your tongs after serving a dog? Okay, I have, and I'll tell you the truth, I've hung them on my daggum handles a blue million times. But I learned, because I got in trouble, is I will keep a metal pan, just a small pan, like a 1/6 size pan, but a deep one, okay, like a 6-inch pan, right on top of my cart where all my tongs go. My tongs, if I have a extra ladle, whatever, it's going in there. It's going in that pan. That pan's going to stay hot because it's right there by the burners, you know, by the steam table, and that's killing germs. But the bottom line is I'm keeping it there. If you get real busy and you start to get a mess on your ladle, you got chili halfway up it and it's starting to crust up because it's dry, change it out. Please, dear God, change it out. It looks filthy, okay? The vendor, though, that I was watching that day, Jeff, that was a great question. I appreciate it. Because there's alternatives for all this stuff. There's always an alternative. And if you ask your health inspector, they'll dang sure tell you. Now, some inspectors that are new may go, I don't know where you're going to keep it, but you ain't keeping it there. Food from an unsafe source. Okay, that was the last one I was going to get to. Food from an unsafe source is let me give you kind of an example. No joke, I watched a vendor do this. He was serving something that required sour cream. He took, and the sour cream, he was squeezing it. Well, the bottom ripped a little bit on this plastic squeezer. So it was coming out both ends, basically, when he squeezed. So what did he do? He squeezed the rest of it out, kind of rolled it like toothpaste, out onto the top of his cart, but on like an aluminum foil sheet, you know, the separate... He can't even put it back in the fridge. And he literally was serving, scooping out of that mess onto the customer's meal. as quesadillas, by the way. Never do that. That's an unsafe source. Let's say you made Coke onions, and you made those in your commissary, but you're toting them in that awesome pail that Mama gave you that she used to tote biscuits in because you want to use it. That's an unsafe source. Maybe it's cast iron and it's pitted up. Unsafe source. Okay? For toting, onions. Cooked onions. So, could you tote raw potatoes in it? Yes. But they got all these little rules, but I'm trying to just keep you... Forget the minutia of the rules. If you'll just keep it in the source that it's supposed to be in, a non-porous Tupperware even. Most inspectors will let you use a Tupperware. They do make commercial grade Tupperware, and the only difference between it and regular Tupperware is it says commercial grade. So if you have a sticker, you can put a sticker on the side that says commercial grade. Now you got commercial grade because there ain't no difference. Okay, as long as it's food safe items, you're allowed to use it in the right, like the sour cream. Even though that aluminum foil sheet is safe to use, it's not safe to use for sour cream. Okay? So, here, I'm going to run through these real quick, and then I'll try to get to any questions that got asked. Okay? In inspections, real inspections, and I was attempting to get an inspector on here with me. I've done it twice before, and I was going to try to get an inspector to kind of give his take on everything. So you could hear it out of his words. He still may come on. Okay, so I'm trying to get it. It's so ridiculous now with dotting your I's, crossing your T's. They have to be careful what they say. His boss called me, who's the director for the state, and he told me, he goes, well, we have to get this signed off. What questions are going to be asked? Well, I'm going, listen, this ain't a gotcha thing. I'm trying to get y'all to help vendors. Blah. Anyway, here's the top five things. These are the top five violations in order, okay, nationwide. Improper holding temperatures happens to be the number one thing they're looking for. Did you notice that? So improper holding temperatures is the number one thing that gets vendors in trouble. Not some big fine, not anything. It's typically a mark on their sheet, and they'll reinspect in 2 days and go, okay, let me check your temperatures. Oh, you're good now. Thank you. Now, number two. Hand washing facilities not accessible or improperly supplied. No joke. Had a vendor call me crying. Lady, she was crying. She had just failed her inspection. She got like a 70 or something. It was ridiculous. But she didn't have water in her tank, had no hand sanitizer, had no soap. She had never been inspected in 2 years. I ain't never been inspected. And they inspected me, and they failed me because of this and this. Well, you can still vend, right? Yes, I can still vend, but now I have to post this up on my cart, and it doesn't look good. And I said, well, have a reinspection. It costs for a reinspection. We'll get one anyway because it's going to cost you more having that crappy code. You have a crappy score on your cart. So hand washing facilities, make sure they're working. Okay, actually have water in them. Lack of food handler training. Okay, this comes down to everything. Okay, sometimes they'll bucket load everything into the same bucket. They'll take all your mistakes and put it in one bucket. Improper food handler training. All that comes down to is they figure you've got like 7 errors. It's probably training issue, and they'll write that in. That's number 3. Number 4, contaminated. Now, this is another one. If your state requires you to be food safety certified, either through ServSafe or one of the millions of others, they will, and you didn't have it, or your employee didn't have the license displaying and you're the manager of it and you didn't have it, they can get you there too. Okay, contaminated food contact surfaces. What is a contaminated food contact surface? Well, that would be where you took something from, let's say you had something dirty and you set it up on top of your cart where you prep. Even though when you prep food, you've got something else down, but the surface, the top of that cart or the counter or your shelf had something on it prior. So let's say he watches you from a distance or she and you're counting money, okay, counting money on your counter. And then you take that money up and put it in your thing, right? business starts picking up, you start working again, and you lay some buns up there, even though those buns are sitting in something like a hot dog boat, or you put your hand on it with your glove, you just cross-contaminated. So that's a contaminated food contact area. The other is, this goes right back to number two, lack of hot water. So some people will go, I ain't going to worry about it, I ain't been inspected, like this girl that called crying. She had been inspected after 2 years, never been inspected. All of a sudden, she gets inspected, booyah, she didn't have her water system up and running. And that was dumb. It was dumb. You wouldn't want to go to some place like that. So don't think they're not going to get on to you if you didn't do it. And I can tell you this. If you'll do these things the right way, if you'll just run your cart like you would want to eat at one, you won't have any problems. Okay? Let me pull up. I had made some other notes here. Always keep your garbage away. Don't have it touch in the cart. So vendors sometimes, for wind reasons or whatever, they'll have them a garbage can for them and a garbage can for the customers. They might have them a little one for their gloves, but they got it touch in the cart. You're contaminating a food area. It probably take 100 inspectors before one got you on that. But those are things you want to look out for. You want to wipe down all the time, okay? Most states require you have sanitization solution, which is water and a cap full of bleach. A gallon of water, cap full of bleach, okay? So that's a tablespoon, I believe, or two tablespoons. I think it's a tablespoon of bleach per gallon of water is a safe sanitization solution. Most states require that you have the pool strips that check chlorine, they'll require you have those all times so they can check your sanitization solution. So they'll come over there. They won't use theirs. They'll check yours with your strips. So they'll take your pool strip, they'll dip it in there and go, oh, you're good to go. You got enough bleach in there. Okay? So always have a little more bleach if you wonder. Have some rags in there. Pull those rags out, wring them out when you're not as busy, or if you need to stop for a second because it's starting to get sloppy, you've splashed some chili up on the top of the cart, go ahead and clean it up. The next people will really appreciate that, knowing they just watched you. They'd rather wait 10 seconds longer and have a clean cart that they're ordering from. Sunshine Hot Dog says, let me pull this up. I gotta change camera view here. Let's see. Sunshine Hot Dog says, change gloves every time you change an activity. That's true. You can use one glove. One glove, one money hand, one glove, one money hand. You're allowed to mess with your tongs without a glove, okay? But you're allowed to touch food without a glove in most states. But you can't touch nothing else. You're just stuck. You touch the side of your cart or bump into something, now you've contaminated. So change the gloves. And a lot of vendors are using the latex gloves, even if it's all natural latex, whatever you're not allergic to. Okay, and then over it, those food gloves that are kind of like mitts, and they're real easy. They'll hang them off their cart, stick their hand in it, pull it out, it rips one off, and now they're ready to go again. And those are easy to come off because you can shake them off. You don't even have to replace this glove, you just replace that glove, and you can keep going. It looks clean, it looks better. I like to wash my hands every now and then because that even looks good. Even if your fingernails aren't dirty, even if you know you just washed your hands, 30 minutes ago, it's good. It's good to stop. Hey, folks, give me just a second. I want to wash my hands again. And you wash your hands and you go back to work. People love that stuff. Okay? And it's healthy. Less chance of risking somebody else. Let's see. I want to go through these questions and stuff real quick. Okay? I put links down in the video description. I don't know if you can see that yet or if it only shows up after the video posts. I don't know how it works, but I always put links to what I'm going to talk about. I typically try to put links, okay, and some links to other stuff. Like I did that free course I just got done on how to get started with lemonade in 24 hours, be making money, and I used my sisters as an example because they just did it. Joe says, hello, Sunshine Hot Dogs and Catering says hi to everybody out there in Tampa, Florida. Joe, glad you're here. Alan says need to do lemonade, you need to go just check that out. Okay, just go check it out. And that's, I put the link in here, but it's also in there. But you can also get to it by going to learnhotdogs.com/lemon. That'll get you there. That'll take you to an article, and at the bottom of it takes you to that free course. Let me see. Ben, I'll catch you later. He's in church. What up, dog? Had my initial inspection and license today and passed with flying colors. Thanks to you, Ben. Ruth. Ruth just got inspected. Ruth is brand new. She was going to build a cart, and now she bought one, and she's getting started in Colorado, and hopefully we'll get to interview her soon. All right. Bubba Mason says, Ben, my HD said no to lemonade, but how did they say it? Like, is it no period, or can you bottle it at your commissary? Because we've got some vendors that bottle it at their commissary. Well, guess what? Those vendors make a killing, too. You look at Corey Lawrence. He doesn't even have to bottle his at his commissary, and he does it anyway because he sells more lemonade. And you can go to learnhotdogs.com, and you'll see those pictures of him. And a lot of us vendors and Vendors United are doing that now. Mason jars, and you can get a gob of money for it. $6 to $8 for a freaking jar of lemonade. Some vendors, this is the outliers, $10 for a jar of lemonade, quart jar. Let's see. Peace dogs in the house. Gotta love it. Coda Ice, as long as you haven't been serving them. I don't know what I was talking about there. That I get one of your carts, the cash cow, and I love it. Tommy. Tommy says, I get one of your carts, cash cow, and I love it. Thanks, Tommy. I appreciate it a bunch. He's Chattown Dogs. That's Chattanooga, Tennessee. Danny Brown's in the house. Thanks for being here. Apparently, if you live in Alabama, you can't operate an open cart or any concession of any kind. That is not correct. I've got over 100 customers in Alabama, and one of the vendors that we allow people to go and spend a day with a vendor for free is a vendor in Alabama. You can vend in Alabama. Lots of vendors doing good in Alabama. Alabama's a cool place to vend. Two of our vendors in Vendors United are active and just power vendors in Alabama. Okay, according to what I can find after having gone through all 211 pages, the only concession food I can find that Alabama allows is the baked sales for churches. Call the state. Call the state. Don't call your county. Call the state and ask. And I bet you'll find out something different. Because we got vendors doing hot dogs there. We've got all kinds of vendors there. Let's see. And just to give you an idea, I'm sorry to get sidetracked, but I think it's Abrock37 that commented on this, three different comments about this, that the only things you can vend in Alabama. No. Okay, that'd be like Alabama saying, we don't allow pizza in Alabama, no pizza vendors, no Pizza Huts, no Hungry Howies, no Papa John's, no none of it, no Domino's, no pizza. They can't do that. If it's a legal business, like you ain't growing meth, okay, they have to allow it. They can't, like, say, oh, we don't allow that in our state. We just don't allow it. Nope, doesn't fly. It violates the federal law, which is under the Bill of Rights, under the Constitution, Bill of Rights, the big stuff. David says I should post a video as what not to do video. There's so many of those, though. There's more of those than what you should do. I can tell you a bunch of stuff that I've seen vendors do that's horrid, like the vendor that I filmed for 2 hours. I thought I was going to have he sets up an awesome setup, but then he sloppy vends. And here's the deal. I could have eaten there. My wife could have eaten there, and we didn't intentionally on purpose because I was scared to death of his food. Jeff Mack, he keeps a number 3 boat on the shelf to keep his tongs in. That's a great one. Don't forget to stir your chili. Absolutely. Maybe keep a little water. Add a little water to it every now and then. You can even let some cream cheese slip in there every now and then, and it makes it creamier. It's cool. Castro says, finally, you're back. I have been slammed. I've been... I've had people email me and go, when are you going to do another video? Well, a lot of this comes down to y'all, too. If I don't get questions that other than like, hey, Ben, where'd you get that cool hat? I don't need to do a video about that. But if you got questions about vending or you want to see me cover something, just suggest it, and I'll try to get to it. I don't care what it is. I care what it is. Don't tell me to do, naked jump off a bridge or something. Just if it's something to do with vending, I'll be happy to try to figure out a way to get it filmed or done for you or something or explained. Sunshine Dog says, hey, Castro, I like your story. I'm going to be interviewing Castro again. Do y'all remember Castro? We interviewed a while back now, maybe 2 months ago, and he's got updates, and so we're going to interview him again. I say we, like I got three people in my pocket, but I'm going to interview him, and we'll go through what he's learned from then to now and how the family's doing, how he's doing. If y'all don't remember a story, you need to go watch that video. Let's see. Thanks for the comments, Pat. That was nice. The mason jars kicking butt. Let me tell you, mason jars kick butt. I'm not even going to try to pronounce your username, but is there any reason why someone can't vend or start a car catering business in any state? Nope. Nope. Eric, nope. No. I mean, can you imagine a state, just a random state, going, yeah, we don't allow ice cream in Tennessee. We just don't. Bull crap. You can't just arbitrarily come up with a business, a whole section of business, to not allow. Now, I mean, they just can't do it. And the reason why any state would attempt that, and I know of no state that does that, I personally have vendors in every state in the country. Personally, as far as I have people that I've helped, trained, or taught, or sold a cart to that have a cart in every state in the country. Some of them hundreds of carts in those states. So I know for a fact there's no state that doesn't allow vending. Now, what you can vend, they can limit that. Where you can vend, they can limit that to a certain extent. They can't be discriminatory with it. Check this out. Tommy says, also have to give a big shout out to Pop's Dogs and Chattanooga, Tennessee for helping me get my feet wet. That's exactly right. If y'all follow Tommy, he's got a YouTube channel, and he posts up his updates, and he went and visited with a vendor and worked with a vendor. Let's see. Here's Candace. We started doing lemonade and strawberry lemonade and mason jars. People love it, love it, love them. Thank you, Candace. Candace has a Stand King. Her and her husband have been vending about almost getting close to a year, I believe. And they're out in the Arkansas, where I have a daughter just moved to Arkansas about 4 days ago. Okay. I'm reading these. Okay, Wooden Sun. Found an awesome little pushcart today for a bargain with a ton of extras. Going to get this week. Can't wait to start getting familiar with it and getting out there making money. Absolutely. Absolutely. I think it's awesome. And if you'll do your due diligence, take the time to do some of the due diligence. I've put it in bite-sized sections. And I know you can get to my learnhotdogs.com site and get overwhelmed, but not all of it's going to apply to you. It's because we've been doing that site for years. There's a lot of information, and I keep updating information. Like recently I just put out an update, but the point is I've broke it down. If you click on the start training, it'll go through six short videos to get you an idea of the landscape. If you want to know how much vendors make, I got it on there, based on thousands of vendors who share information with me. Love this. Pat says, had my first in the field inspection yesterday and passed the flying colors. Inspector again complimented the big dog cart. That's one of mine. Now it's Pat's. As one of the nicest she's seen. That's freaking awesome. thank you a bunch, Pat. I didn't pay Pat to put that up here, but I was going to share it. Wasn't going to let that go. Raymond's in the house to every city. Dogs and catering out of Louisville, Kentucky. I bet I said Louisville, Kentucky, till I was 40. Now I say Louisville. I got corrected. So, anyway, I hope this helps you. I hope that it'll take away a lot of that pressure of what to expect when one arrives, what things to know always to be doing on your cart. And it's not one of those things. I'm not like warning you, like, oh, do this. You can sneak by with this. No, this isn't a sneak by thing. This is food safety, and you need to do it the right way. Because if they get reports that three people got sick from your cart, guess what they can do? They can shut you down, and they put it on a public website, and it looks like crap. Do it the right way, and you will further the value of street food vendors worldwide by doing it the right way. Do it clean, even if it means you lose some sales because your line's going slower. Do it the right way, and you will make more money, and you will have a valuable business, whether you're going to sell it or give it away one day to one of your kids or grandkids. If you do it the right way, you'll have built a huge value. So I love you. I wish you the best, and I'll talk to you soon. I'll be back a lot sooner than this last time.